Miss Udina, we are live now. You can start.
Okay, thank you. Hello, namaste, and good evening to all. Myself, Sudhina Shrestha. On behalf of our Optum Group, I would like to welcome all the audience connected with us through this e-learning live session today. Starting this session with certain about for Optum. For Optum students, presentation is initiated by for Optums, where students can present on optometry-related topics. Today, we have Ms. Anjali with us. Currently, she is pursuing Master's in Optometry at University of Hyderabad. She is enthusiastic optometry student, keen about community optometry. Today, she is going to present about peripheral corneal disease. As this is going to be a live session, I would like to request all our audience, if you have any queries related to the presentation, you can drop it on the chat box. We'll be discussing all the queries at the end of the session. It's over to you, Anjali. Wish you all the best.
Thank you very much. I'm very excited to be here on this platform today. Without much ado, I will begin with the presentation. So today I will be discussing about the peripheral corneal diseases. So the cornea is basically the transparent anterior part of the eye. Next slide, please. Hello. Hello,
Monish?
I think there is, the slide is not changing. Okay. Yes, thank you. So the cornea is the anterior transparent part of the eye that is composed of 80% water and 20% of organic and inorganic materials. It comprises of six layers. Next slide, please. Cornea is grossly divided into the peripheral and the central zone. It accounts for the structural and anatomical differences. The peripheral cornea is flatter and thicker when compared to the central cornea. It is supplied by the perilimbal vessels and also has the increased number applied by the conjunctivitis. As we know, conjunctiva has the capacity to generate immune-mediated responses. Next slide, please. This table represents
Manish, enlarge the screen.
The peripheral and the central cornea. So while that is going on, I'll just tell about the topics that I will be discussing today. It is basically about the peripheral corneal diseases. It can include the direct infection by the microorganisms or hypersensitivity mediated responses, even metabolic or dermal conditions also affect the cornea, along with other systemic conditions. So in this presentation, we will be looking at them briefly. Next slide, please.
Hello, I have changed the slide. Is it visible or not?
Yes. Can you change it again? So the direct infection in the peripheral cornea can be a result of bacteria, viral, fungal, chlamydial, or parasitic infection. The ulcers may begin as epithelial defect or present as stromal infiltration. These can spread circumferentially and may involve the central cornea later on. Next slide, please. This represents the variety of organisms that affect the peripheral cornea under the category of bacteria, virus, chlamydia, fungal, and parasites. Next slide, please. This picture represents the bacterial infiltration at the periphery of the cornea. Next slide, please. So the most common bacterial organisms that affect the peripheral cornea are Staphylococcus aureus, Staphylococcus pneumoniae, Pseudomonas, Haemophilus influenza, and Moraxella. The presentation can be with pain, photophobia, blurred vision, and purulent discharge. The signs include chemosis, eyelid swelling, severe perilimbal association may be, that can lead to scleritis and reduced corneal sensation along with gray-white ulcers with defined or irregular borders. Next slide, please. Next slide, please. Next, we have the fungal infection. Mostly all the fungal organisms that affect the central cornea also affect the peripheral cornea. The presentation can be with pain, blurred vision, photophobia, grittiness, and discharge. The signs include yellow-white suppurative candidal infection or yellow-white fluffy margined filamental infiltrates. Next picture, please. Here in the second picture, you can see how in the peripheral infiltrate, the margins of the infiltration is quite uneven and not defined. Next slide, please. Now coming to the viral infection. The most common agents are herpes simplex, herpes zoster, varicella, adenovirus, Vaccinia, variola molluscum, and Epstein-Barr virus. The herpes simplex keratitis has an atypical presentation. Stromal infiltrates follow dendrite formation in a recurrent form. It may also mimic catarrhal ulceration. And we need to be sure about the infection. Otherwise, the wrong diagnosis may lead to increasing the severity of the infection. Next, we have the peripheral herpetic stromal keratitis that can be more severe and is seen with iritis and keratic precipitates. Herpes zoster and varicella commonly affect the peripheral cornea. Herpes zoster has two epithelium forms, the early dendritic form and the delayed dendritic mucoid plaques. Scleritis may be associated. Next, we have the varicellar infection. The peripheral dendrites with vascular limbal lesions are seen. Perilimbal infiltration and vascularization with stromal involvement is not uncommon. Next, we have Vaccinia and variola. They form limbal pustules with peripheral corneal involvement. They may also lead to ulcer formation. Next slide. Yes. Now we have the molluscum contagiosum and Verruca vulgaris virus that usually results in the peripheral keratitis in conjunction with the eyelid lesions. It usually begins as a punctate epithelial erosion and later progresses. Next slide, please. Here you can see the periphery of the eye has been affected by a herpes simplex virus. Next slide, please. Now coming to the chlamydial infection. Limbus and peripheral cornea is usually affected by this infection. The signs involve edema, infiltration of the limbal conjunctiva, limbal follicles, punctate epithelial keratitis, subepithelial infiltrates, and microscopic or gross pannus and vascularized ulcers are also seen. The Rieter syndrome commonly involves peripheral keratitis. Next slide, please. Now, parasitic infection can have two causes commonly in the peripheral cornea, that is Onchocerca volvulus and Acanthamoeba. Onchocerca microfilaria causes punctate keratitis, affecting the superficial 1/3 of the stroma nasally and temporally. The dead microfilariae is usually surrounded by the punctate keratitis and that shows as a fluffy stromal opacity. Next slide, please. Acanthamoebal keratitis can be associated with the contact lens wear or with a history of rinsing contact lens with tap water or any other vegetative matter infection. The presentation can be with blurred vision, discomfort, or severe pain. The signs include epithelial pseudodendrites, limbitis with stromal infiltrates, radial keratoneuritis, and infiltrates in the form of ring abscess. Scleritis and corneal melt can also be seen. Next slide, please. Some of the systemic infections can also cause sterile peripheral infiltrates or ulceration. These include bacillary dysentery, brucellosis. This is the kind of a zoonotic infection. Mumps, influenza, dengue fever, and infectious mononucleosis. Now, what are the investigations and treatment that we can do for the direct infection? The investigation usually involve corneal and conjunctival scraping, contact lens case culture, Gram staining for the bacterial infection, culture and sensitivity, and PCR analysis is also effective as it is almost 90% sensitive. Confocal microscopy can give a good picture of the fungal infection. Clinical diagnosis can be made in case of viral infection and staining can also be done. And treatment for the bacterial infection involves antibiotic therapy, mydriatics, and steroids. Fungal infection can be treated with epithelium removal, antifungal, antibiotic, and cycloplegic or tetracycline treatment or AC washout. Next slide, please. Herpes simplex keratitis is usually treated with antiviral that can be topical or oral, debridement, interferon monotherapy, cycloplegics and antiviral steroid cycloplasia and cyclosporin. Whereas the herpes zoster keratitis includes the use of antiviral steroid therapy for immunocompromised patients. Next slide, please. Acanthamoebal infection is treated by topical amebocides, steroids, non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs or therapeutic PK. Next, we have the onchocerciasis infection that can be treated with ivermectin, moxidectin, doxycycline, suramin, and steroids. Next slide, please. Now we come into the hypersensitivity disorders. This can be local or systemic hypersensitivity or immune-mediated responses in the peripheral cornea. And these include local allergic reaction to bacterial toxin, airborne antigen, and systemic anaphylactic reaction. Next slide, please. Now, the first in this comes marginal keratitis. These are hypersensitivity reaction to the bacterial antigen, usually staphylococcal exotoxin, and these are found in the lid margins. The presentation can be bilateral with mild discomfort, redness, lacrimation, foreign body sensation. Neutrophil dysfunction with severity in young patient is seen.
Next slide, please. The signs of marginal keratitis include gray-white stromal or subepithelial infiltrates with a clear zone in the limbus. Chronic blepharitis and conjunctival involvement is seen, along with inferior punctate epitheliopathy, coalescence and circumferential spread. It can be treated with weak steroids and antibiotics. Blepharitis treatment can also be done and tetracycline is also used. Next slide, please. Here you can see at the periphery of the cornea, there is a small marginal keratitis and it has a lucid space between the limbus. Next slide, please. Now coming to flectinulosis. These are delayed hypersensitivity reaction to antigens or tuberculosis or helminth infestation. The presentation involves photophobia, lacrimation, blepharospasm. And signs include small white limbal or conjunctival nodule with intense hyperema, limbal flectin that extends onto cornea, large necrotizing or lesions may occur. Next slide, please. Okay. It heals with a triangular scar, vascularization, and scarring. Rarely thinning leads to perforation. It is usually treated with topical steroids, antibiotics, and treatment associated with blepharitis. Next slide, please. Here you can see at the limbal end, there is a small lesion-like appearance, and it is associated with hyperema in the conjunctiva. Next slide, please. Next comes the vernal keratoconjunctivitis. This is usually seen in the warm and dry climate countries. It is a recurrent bilateral seasonal conjunctival inflammation involving the peripheral and paracentral cornea. Usually, young males are affected. It is an IgE and cell-mediated response to the hypersensitivity or allergy. Symptoms include intense itching with lacrimation, photophobia, foreign body sensation, ptosis, creased blinking, mucoid rope strand discharge. Next slide, please. It is usually categorized into three types. The first one is the palpebral VKC. It involves the superior tarsal conjunctiva with hyperemia, papillary hypertrophy that may progress into cobblestone hypertrophy, and it affects the corneal epithelium. The second one is the limbal vernal keratoconjunctivitis that has a gelatinous superior limbal thickening and opacification. Horner stranta spots are also seen. Thickened conjunctiva over peripheral cornea is also not uncommon. And the third one involves the signs and symptoms of both the limbal and the palpebral VKC. Next, coming into corneal involvement, it involves punctate keratitis, that is the superior cornea is involved with epithelium disruption, pseudogeratoxin, vascularization and ectasia. Severe forms can lead to necrotizing epithelium. Ulcerative keratitis with shallow shield ulcers are also seen. These may lead to secondary infection if delayed re-epithelialization is done. Next slide, please. The treatment is basically on three levels. The primary one is to avoid the allergen, use cold compresses involving lid hygiene, and even use of bandaged contact lenses to avoid corneal involvement. The second one is the use of antihistamine, mast cell stabilizers, antibiotics, vasoconstrictors, corticosteroids, and mucolytics. And the last one involves the superficial keratectomy or surface maintenance or restoration procedures. Next slide, please. Here in the picture at the back, you can see the presentation of stranta spot, and also the conjunctiva is quite scarred in the shield-like ulcers. Now coming to the immune corneal rings. These are also known as Wiesley rings. These are non-infectious ring-shaped infiltration. Intracorneal interaction of antigen and antibody diffusing from the limbal blood vessel and plasma cell leads to this formation. Stromal infiltration attracts inflammatory cells. Next slide, please. It can be a result of bacterial endotoxins or even a virus infection like herpes. The studies have also shown that these rings contain antigen-antibody complex complements, polymorphonuclear leukocyte cells. Next slide, please. Here you can see the white coloration across the corneal border. That is the immune ring. Next slide, please. Now coming on to the Mourin's ulcer. This is a rare autoimmune disease. It usually shows in the peripheral circumferential stromal ulceration, and it progresses to reach the center. It is basically of two types. The first one usually affects the elderly unilaterally and has a good response to medical intervention, while the second one affects the young bilaterally and has aggressive with severe pain. It has poor response to the medical therapy. Next slide, please. The symptoms include pain, blurred vision, photophobia. Signs involve stromal ulceration with epithelial loss, leading edge, limbitis, iritis, vascularization. The complications involved are high astigmatism, spontaneous perforation, secondary infection, glaucoma, and cataract. It can be treated with topical steroids, cyclosporin, collagenase inhibitors, systemic immunosuppression, conjunctival resection, and lamellar keratectomy. Next slide. Here you can see the cornea is involved totally with the Mourin's ulcer in the peripheral part. Next slide, please. Now coming to anaphylactic marginal keratitis. Anaphylaxis is essentially a severe life-threatening allergic reaction. Occasionally, peripheral cornea is involved. The signs include bilateral, multiple peripheral stromal infiltrate that may coalesce to form a ring. And it also has a clear zone. Treatment involves systemic treatment of anaphylaxis and corticosteroids. Next slide, please. Now coming on to degenerations. These can be infectious, immunological, systemic alteration that can occur at the peripheral cornea. Next slide, please. The first one are age-related degenerations. These are of three types. Let's look at them. Next slide, please. The first one is the arcus senilis. It is the most common degeneration of the peripheral cornea. It is seen in almost 60% of the people in the 40s and 60 years. It is bilateral, symmetrical, lipid deposition. Cholesterol, triglycerides, and phospholipids are seen in an hourglass distribution. Pathogenesis involves increased permeability of limbal vessels. Next slide, please. Age and atherosclerosis. This causes slow diffusion of low-density lipoproteins and associated lipids into the stroma. And hypercholesterolemia affects the young children. Occasionally, non-inflammatory thinning can also be seen as senile furrow. Next slide, please. Here you can see the clear zone between the limbus and the arcus formation. Next slide, please. Next slide, please. Now coming on to white limbus.
Hello.
these are bilateral symmetry. So the second type is the similar band formation without the clear limbal zone or the holes. Subepithelial elastotic degeneration at the Bowman's layer and anterior stroma are seen. Next slide, please. Here you can see at the periphery, there is a white deposition, and that represents the white limbus girdles of. Next slide, please. Now comes the Hassel-Henley's body. These are seen in elderly patient. These are localized outgrowth of Descemet's membrane at the periphery. On a specular reflection, it may appear as dark holes in the endothelial mosaic and may imitate guttate formation. Next slide, please. Here you can see how at the endothelial level the shadow is formed. Next slide, please. Now coming on to the spheroidal degeneration. It has a multitude of names coming from Labrador degeneration, climate droplet degeneration to nodular corneal dystrophy of Batey and oil droplet degeneration. It mainly occurs in outdoor working men exposed to the ultraviolet or secondary to injury or inflammation. Usually, the Bowman's layer is replaced by a proteinaceous deposits in the anterior stroma. Next slide, please. The signs include amber granules in the peripheral, interpalpebral cornea, in the superficial stroma with surrounding a hazy stroma and may involve the conjunctiva. Friedman and Fraunfelder et al. Have classified spheroidal degeneration. Treatment includes protection from the ultraviolet exposure, superficial keratectomy, and lamellar keratoplasty. Next slide, please. Here you can see how the cornea is involved in the spheroidal degeneration inferiorly. Next slide, please. Now coming on to pterygium. It is a vascularized, triangular, fleshy bulbar conjunctiva that actively progresses onto the cornea. The reason for it can be due to ultraviolet exposure or chronic surface dryness. This is again an elastoidotic degenerative change in the vascularized stromal collagen. Symptoms include irritation and grittiness that is associated with Dellen or due to the edge lift in the contact lens wearer or intermittent inflammation. But usually it is asymptomatic. Next slide, please. The signs include Stalker's line, Fuchs islets, and pseudopterygia. Treatment is only done when it is symptomatic or in the visual axis, causing corneal distortion and irregular astigmatism. Using protection, surgical excision, and adjuncts like beta irradiation and mitomycin C can be used for treatment. Next slide, please. Here in the first slide, you can see that the arrow is pointing at the Stalker's line at the head of the pterygium. And in the second drawing, you can see that the spots ahead of the head represent the Fuchs islets. Next slide, please. Pterygium also involves complication to the peripheral cornea. These can be scarring, thinning, vascularization, and distortion. whereas adjunct theory can also cause punctate keratitis. Next slide, please. Coming on to band keratopathy. This is a calcareous degeneration of the Bowman's layer, an anterior stroma with lucid space involving visual axis eventually. It is a chalky appearance with the transparent holes and clefts. The central progression causes epithelial distortion, erosion, severe pain, and decreased visual acuity. The causes can be ocular, age-related, and systemic, related to metabolic disorders. Next slide, please. The therapy includes disodium EDTA, which is a calcium chelator, post-epithelial scraping, diamond burr, excimer laser keratectomy, lamellar keratoplasty are also used, and treating the underlying ocular and systemic condition can also help. Next slide, please. Here you can see the inferior of the cornea. There is an extension of the band keratopathy with transparent holes. Next slide, please. Now coming on to Delenn. These are saucer-shaped excavations with defined margins at the periphery of the cornea. It is usually a result of hypoxia or stromal dehydration. It can be caused second paralimbal elevation, surgery or trauma, long-term use of contact lens, conjunctival chemosis or hemorrhage, or paralytic lagophthalmos. Symptoms include grittiness, redness, and foreign body sensation. Treatment is usually not required as it resolves in 1 or 2 days. But some conditions, such as where blebs are used in the glaucoma surgery, where the elevation cannot be treated, artificial tears can be used, or for other problems like pterygium, surgery can be done. Next slide, please. Here you can see the Delenn formation close to the conjunctival hemorrhage. Next slide, please. Terrain's marginal degeneration. It is an idiopathic, bilateral, non-inflammatory marginal degeneration of the cornea. It is slow progressing and usually affects the young male. There is a furrowing ectasia in the superior cornea and can lead to spontaneous perforation. It may be full and recurrent with episodes of episcleritis or scleritis. Fibrillar degeneration with lipid infiltration of the stromal collagen fiber is seen. Next slide, please. The epithelial basement membrane and the Bowman's layer may be absent or even high irregular or against the rule astigmatism is usually associated. Treatment can be by using protective spectacles, contact lenses, or even surgery. Clinical stages include the first stage, that is marginal opacification with vascularization. The second stage involves furrow in cornea, irregular lipid deposits, and the third stage involves thinning, progressive thinning, and associated astigmatism. Next slide, please. Here, as you can see, the cornea is sort of completely involved in a ring-like manner in the terrain's marginal degeneration. Next slide, please. Now coming on to pellucid marginal degeneration. It is again a rare idiopathic marginal degeneration of the peripheral cornea. Ectatic and slow progressive thinning, and that usually involves the inferior cornea. Symptoms include slow vision degradation in association with astigmatism. Signs include crescent band of thinning inferiorly, usually 1 millimeter from the limb, from the limbus. Ectatic and flattening of cornea is also seen, along with thinning, that is crescentic with the limbus, and there is an inferior steep drop. Next slide, please. 80% of the stroma is usually lost and Bowman's layer is absent. The topography shows a dove, two pigeons or a butterfly-like pattern with severe astigmatism and inferior steepening. Treatment can be spectacle for protection, contact lens for astigmatism, and surgery for perforation. Other options like corneal ring implants and collagen cross-linking can also be used. Next slide, please. Here you can see the topographic map. This is sort of a hallmark for pellucid marginal degeneration. And in the pictures above, you can see how the slit sort of curves at the inferior portion of the cornea. Next slide, please. Now coming on to the mass lesions that affect the periphery of the cornea. In young children, dermoid is the reason, whereas in adults, epithelial dystrophy and other malignancies can be seen. Conjunctival and corneal tumors can also affect the peripheral cornea. Next slide, please. Now, the first one is dermoid. It is congenital choristomatous lesion formed from the primitive tissues. Choristomatous can be thought of as normal tissue growing in the abnormal skin. The dermal elements are associated with choristomatous lesion. These include hair follicles, fat, lacrimal or sweat glands, smooth muscles, connective tissues, and keratinized epithelium. It can occur in isolation or with other conditions like the golden heart syndrome, trachear colon syndrome, and linear nevus sebaceous of Jadenson. Next slide, please. The limbus and the peripheral cornea is involved usually with no true growth in the dermoid. Limbal dermoid may involve conjunctiva and sclera. The grades are based on the area involved, shape and size of the dermoid. Treatment is usually done if Dellen or astigmatism is present. Otherwise, shaving the elevated portion or lamellar keratoplasty is also done. Next slide, please. Here you can see the peripheral cornea in association with a dermoid. And you can see how the hair follicles have grown out of them. Next slide, please. Now, coming on to epithelial tumors. These are usually nasal, bilateral, and symmetrical. Grayish-white interepithelial plaques are usually seen with the fibrillated epithelial tumors. Corneal epithelium is usually involved in absence of conjunctival disease. Rose Bengal is used to stain the corneal and conjunctival epithelial involvement. Next slide, please. Dysplasia or neoplastic limbal lesions are usually fleshy and vascularized. In early stages, they appear as flat plaques with leukoplakia and vascularization. The diagnosis and treatment is based on excisional biopsy of the limbal or the conjunctival lesion. Corneal lesion can be scraped out. Next slide, please. Here, the squamous cell carcinoma of the cornea usually develops from the pre-existing limbal epithelial dysplasia or carcinoma in situ. Thick elevated vascularized lesion with gelatinous appearance is seen. Treatment is usually done with excisional biopsy, frozen section. Intraocular invasion involves the procedure like enucleation or evisceration. Next slide, please. Here, the picture right at the back involves the dysplasia next to the peripheral cornea. In the second, we can see neoplastic changes. And in the third one, we can see carcinoma associated with the peripheral cornea. Next slide. Other tumors can be benign or malignant tumors that affect the limbus and the peripheral cornea. Superficial or intraocular, these tumors can be. Limbal melanomas are pre-existing melanosis or conjunctival nevi. Papillomas, xanthogranulomas, carcinomas, fibrous histiocytomas are also seen. Next slide. Now coming on to traumatic or toxic lesions. Cornea insult due to toxic anti-agents or trauma mostly involves the peripheral cornea, as the central cornea is usually protected by the reflex blinking. Adverse reaction to the contact lens wear also involves the peripheral cornea. Next slide, please. Now, these are the other conditions that also affect the peripheral cornea. Let us look at them. Next slide. Superior limbic keratoconjunctivitis. It is an idiopathic bilateral inflammation of the superior tarsal and bulbar conjunctiva. Limbus and peripheral cornea is also associated. It is seen in 3% of the thyroid eye disease patient. Blink-related trauma or otherwise trauma and contact lens wear is associated. Symptoms include foreign body sensation, burning sensation, mild photophobia, mucus discharge, frequent blinking. Cornea is involved as punctate epithelial erosion, thickening and keratitis. Next slide, please. Investigations include thyroid function test, biopsy, or impression cytology. Treatment involves lubricants, acetylcysteine, mast cell stabilizer, steroids, cyclosporin, contact lens, and resection. Next slide, please. Here, the superior limbic keratoconjunctivitis is stained with the lecithamine green stain, and you can see the involvement superiorly. Next slide. Now, coming on to keratoconjunctivitis sicca. This results from tear film abnormalities that affect the inferior cornea mostly. Lack of thalamus and exposure can result in sterile marginal ulcers. In severe cases, ulceration and band keratopathy is also seen. Treatment involves the use of lubricants and therapeutic lenses that act as tear reservoirs. Next slide, please. Here again, the lecithamine has stained the conjunctiva and cornea that is involved in the dry eye. Next slide, please. Now coming on to exposure keratopathy. It is an ocular surface disorder that results from exposure. The cause can be neuroparalytic, mechanical, reduced muscle tone, skin tightening, proptosis, post-surgery, or lack of thalamus. Symptoms are similar to that of the dry eye. Signs include epithelial changes, stromal melting and perforation, Zaltzmann degeneration, and secondary infection. It can be treated with artificial tears, lid taping, bandaged contact lenses, and surgery like tarsorrhaphy. Next slide, please. Now coming on to the various systemic condition, it can be divided broadly into three types: vasculitis, dermatological condition, and metabolic conditions. Next slide, please. Here, these are the various conditions that affect the peripheral cornea. Let's look at the first one, that is vasculitis. Next slide, please. It is a chronic multi-system idiopathic disorder of unknown etiology. Peripheral ulcerative keratitis is usually seen with the systemic vascular disorders. The mechanism involves immune complex deposition, episcleral and conjunctival capillary occlusion with secondary cytokine release, and inflammatory cell recruitment, upregulation of collagenase, and decreased inhibitor activity. Next slide, please. Here, as you can see, the periphery of the cornea presents the peripheral ulcerative keratitis. Next slide, please. The first one among the vasculitis is rheumatoid arthritis. This is the most common vascular disorder that affects the eye. It is an autoimmune inflammatory disorder and affects mostly women from 30 to 40 years. The prodromal symptoms include joint pain, stiffness with periarticular and extraarticular involvement, including the subcutaneous nodules, cardiac involvement, pulmonary diseases, and ocular diseases. Immunological assessment can reveal rheumatoid factors and immune complex in the serum levels, decreased complement level, serum cycloglobulins, and ANA antibodies. Now, the ocular involvement usually includes keratoconjunctivitis sicca, scleritis, which is a sign of a systemic vasculitis, episcleritis, and corneal changes. Corneal changes can be an extension of scleritis, and these are usually of four types: sclerosing keratitis, acute stromal keratitis, furrowing, and keratolysis. Next slide, please. Now, coming to the first one, sclerosing keratitis. It is the most common symptom. It is the peripheral thickening, gray crystalline stromal opacification near the scleral inflammation. This progresses centrally and involves stromal vascularization. This may later include lipid deposition, vascularization, and opacification. Acute stromal keratitis. These are superficial or mild stromal peripheral infiltrates that form diffuse opacification. The opacities result in epithelium breakdown and stromal melting. Next slide, please. Peripheral corneal furrowing. These begin near the sclerosing keratitis and spread circumferentially with little vascularization and lipid deposition into the gutter. Severe thinning can be seen in necrotizing scleritis, and limbal furrowing is usually seen in adult arthritis. Keratolysis is the acute severe stromal melt with necrotizing scleritis or scleromalacian perforance. It is usually prone to spontaneous rupture. Next slide, please. Now, the cornea sometimes gets involved with the episcleritis, but these symptoms are usually milder when compared to the scleritis involvement. It usually involves the stromal edema, infiltration, opacification, and vascularization occur in the recurrent forms. Delin formation can be also seen next to the scleral nodule. Treatment of ocular symptoms of the rheumatoid arthritis primarily involves the control of scleritis and episcleritis with corticosteroids or immunosuppressive agents, topical collagenase inhibitors, therapeutic lens, or cyanoacrylate glue is usually used. Furrowing can be arrested with the conjunctival resection, lamellar, or penetrating keratoplasty is also used. Next slide, please. Now, juvenile rheumatoid arthritis is a presentation of arthritis that affects the young, especially those from the age of 16 years. It shows band keratopathy and iridocyclitis as a common sign, and ocular involvement is common among girls and those with a fewer joint involvement and positive ANA antibody. Next slide, please. Systemic lupus erythematosus. It is a multi-system disorder that is articular, cutaneous, renal, hematologic, pulmonary, neurologic, cardiovascular, and ocular system involved. Discoid lupus erythematosus usually affects the skin and the mucous membrane. Ocular complication involves eyelid rash, dry eye syndrome, recurrent erosions, keratitis, corneal furrowing, scleritis, retinal vasculitis, uveitis, orbital edema, vasculitis, and myositis. Next slide, please. The immune complex is usually deposited in the endothelium and forms peripheral infiltrates, interstitial and ulcerative keratitis and endothelitis. Keratoconus may be associated with lupus. The diagnosis is usually based on skin biopsy and blood test. Keratitis usually resolves with the systemic treatment of lupus. Next slide, please. Here, what you can see on the face is called a butterfly rash. That is a common sign of lupus. Next slide, please. Now we have the relapsing polychondritis. It is a common recurrent episodes of inflammatory degeneration of the cartilage and other connective tissues in the body. It involves migratory polyarthritis and constitutional symptoms like fatigue and weight loss. Diffuse chondritis include the external ear, nasal, tracheal, and laryngeal cartilage. These can cause airway obstruction, and including the myocardial and aortic disease can be fatal. Abnormal liver function test is also seen. Next slide, please. The ocular complications involve scleritis and episcleritis, which are a common manifestation, and others are lid edema, iritis, conjunctivitis, keratoconjunctivitis sicca, keratoconus, keratitis that can include a marginal ulcer and furrowing. And next we have the exudative chorioretinitis, exudative retinal detachment, optic neuritis, proptosis, and abducens palsy. Treatment is usually done with topical and systemic corticosteroids. Next slide. Here in the first image, you can see how the pinna of the ear is inflamed. And in the second image, we can see how the peripheral cornea follows the furrowing with opacification. Next slide, please. The Sjögren syndrome. It is an autoimmune disorder that involves the inflammation and destruction of the lacrimal, salivary, and other exocrine organs. The clinical triad is composed of dry eye, dry mouth, and parotid gland enlargement. Dysphagia, odynophagia, and vaginismus are also associated. Secondary Sjögren syndrome is usually associated with connective tissue or collagen vascular tissue diseases. Blood test and imaging test like saliogram, scintigraphy is usually advised. Next slide, please. Symptoms include dryness, grittiness, burning sensation, and stringy discharge. Signs include post-blepharitis, meibomian gland dysfunction, in conjunctiva, redness, chalasis, keratinization. Tear film includes mucin contaminated with lipid, and corneal involvement are punctate erosion, mucus strands and plaques, peripheral infiltrates, ulceration, and perforation with secondary infection. Next slide, please. Investigations include tear breakup time, Schimmer's test, and staining for the eye involvement. Treatment involves environment modifications such as using humidifiers, tear substitutes, punctal occlusion that can be temporary or permanent, steroids for the infiltrates, contact lens, and surgery. Perforation is usually managed with tissue adhesive and bandaged contact lens or keratoplasty. Here in the first slide, you can see the fissures seen in the tongue that is associated with the Sjögren syndrome. And in the second picture, you can see the peripheral corneal involvement with the dry eye. Next slide, please. Now coming on to the vaginous granulomatosis. This is a respiratory vasculitis, and the clinical triad represents necrotizing granulomatous inflammation of the upper and lower respiratory tract, focal glomerulonephritis, and necrotizing vasculitis of small vessels. Primarily, the ocular manifestation can be seen as scleritis, that is usually necrotizing, episcleritis, uveitis, keratitis, that is usually ulcerative, retinal vasculitis, conjunctivitis, retinal detachment, and sudden vision loss. Next slide, please. occlusive vasculitis adjacent to the intrascleral vessels includes the orbit due to the sinus disease. Investigations like tissue biopsy, chest X-ray, blood and urine examination can be done. Treatment usually involves systemic immunosuppressants such as cyclophosphamide and corticosteroids. Next slide, please. The first picture, you can see the dermal involvement in the inferior leg, in the lower limb, sorry. And in the second picture, you can see the eye involvement with lid edema, scleritis, and conjunctival hemorrhage. Next slide, please. Now, coming on to polyarthritis nodosa. This is an episodic necrotizing vasculitis primarily affecting the medium and the small-sized arteries. Male of 20 to 30 years, and especially with the hepatitis infection, are commonly affected. The pathogenesis include immune complex mediated vasculitis. Symptoms are constitutional symptoms, leg tenderness, elevated creatinine and blood pressure, neurological problems, and subcutaneous nodules. Next slide, please. Ocular involvement is seen in 20% of the patients. This includes scleritis, choroidal vasculitis, retinal vasculitis, optic atrophy, exudative retinal detachment, papal edema, peripheral ulcerative keratitis. The keratitis can be associated with the adjunct necrotizing scleritis. The treatment involves systemic corticosteroids, cyclophosphamide, and local measures for the eye. Next slide, please. Here you can see the cutaneous involvement in the polyarthritis nodosa. Next slide, please. Now, coming on to the progressive systemic sclerosis, also known as the scleroderma. It is an immunological sensitization to the skin antigen. The dermal fibroblast proliferation is seen with immature collagen overproduction and vascular ingrowth. Usually, women in their third to fifth decade are affected. Skin, blood vessels, lower esophagus, joints, like arthritis-like presentation, kidney, heart, and lungs are common targets along with Raynaud's phenomena. Ocular manifestation includes keratitis that can be that can cause ulcer and furrowing, keratoconus. Treatment involves immunosuppressants. Next slide, please. Next slide, please. Next slide, please. Hello.
Hello, slides are visible now. Hello?
Yes?
Yes. That slides are visible, no?
Slides are visible, but they are not moving.
Not moving?
Yes.
Now?
No.
What is the slide number you are seeing there?
113.
Now just check it. 114.
No, still the same.
I am changing from here, but it's not showing there.
Hello. It's getting changed in ours also.
Yeah, yeah. I think her the. Now I have kept in 114. Is it there in you are seeing there 114?
Yes, it has changed. So the first picture shows how the sclera is how the skin is affected, and in the second picture of the hand you can see this is the Raynaud's phenomena. Next slide, please. Now coming to the other vasculitis, the cranial arthritis or the giant cell arthritis also affects the peripheral cornea. This leads to vision loss, headache, jaw claudication, diplopia, myalgiasis, and constitutional symptoms. Ocular involvement includes marginal corneal and conjunctival ulcer and scleromalacia. Next is the Cogan syndrome. It is a non-syphilitic interstitial keratitis involving vertigo and deafness. Bilateral peripheral subepithelial numeral opacities are seen. And these both symptoms, syndromes are usually treated with corticosteroids. Next slide, please. In the picture behind, you can see the veins, the vessels in the forehead have been elevated. That is a sign of the cranial vasculitis. And the second one is a sign of the Cogan's disease. Now coming on to the dermatological conditions. Skin conditions can have a primary or a secondary effect on the peripheral cornea. It can develop abnormalities due to the developmental abnormalities, sebaceous gland disorders, and proliferative dermatitis can have a primary effect on cornea, while autoimmune mucous membrane diseases can have a secondary effect through the eyelid or conjunctival changes. Now coming on to the ectodermal dysplasia. This is a group of genetic syndromes that is derived from the ectodermal tissue abnormalities. It usually affects the skin, hair, teeth, nail, and sweat glands. Ocular involvement include cornea, lacrimal system, lens, and retina. Peripheral cornea is affected with neovascularization, pannus, and punctate erosion. Teofilm abnormalities have a secondary effect. Central changes require keratectomy and keratoplasty. Next slide, please. Here in this picture, you can see how there is the dysplasia of the teeth seen in the child. Next slide, please. Rosé. These are chronic idiopathic dermatitis affecting the sebaceous glands, especially in the face. Ocular involvement includes the eyelid in the form of meibomian gland dysfunction or chalazia. Conjunctiva can have hyperemia, and corneal involvement with vascularizing epithelial erosion, marginal keratitis. Symptoms include ocular irritation and lacrimation. It is treated with systemic tetracycline, topical lubricants, antibiotics, and steroids. Next slide, please. Here you can see how in the face the rosé has been presented. Next slide, please. Now coming on to psoriasis. This is a hyperproliferation of the dermal cells resulting in a plaque-like keratotic skin lesion. Arthritis is a common manifestation. Ocular involvement is seen in 10% of the cases. Limbal and peripheral cornea is affected with a flecainune-like lesion, superficial and deep opacity, and epithelial erosion with stromal melt. Next slide, please. Here, as you can see, the dermal involvement has a keratotic kind of an appearance. Next slide, please. Now coming on to eczema. This is an inherited keratotic dermatitis characterized by thick, dry, and scale-like skin. There are four main patterns of ichthyosis. These include ichthyosis vulgaris, X-linked ichthyosis, lamellar ichthyosis, congenital ichthyosiform erythema, and peripheral cornea is involved with the punctate and striate opacities at the desmates membrane, thickened nerves, epithelial opacities, and band keratopathy. Next slide, please. You can see how in the picture there is a severe ectropion of the superior and the inferior eyelids. This can lead to exposure keratopathy of the eye. Next slide, please. Now coming on to keratosis follicularis, also known as the Dreyer's disease. This is an inherited keratotic dermatitis of the hair follicle and intrafollicular epidermis. It is characterized by firm, brown or pink, scaly papules. Peripheral cornea is affected with nebular epithelial opacities, with surface irregularities and peripheral pannus. These are usually asymptomatic and non-progressive. Next slide, please. Here you can see the discoloration of the skin along with a sort of goosebump kind of appearance on the dermis. Next slide, please. Atrodermatitis entropathica. This is usually seen in infants and young children. It is a fatal disease due to the intractable diarrhea that results in severe malnutrition. Clinical triads include dermatitis, diarrhea, and alopecia. Ocular involvement is seen as blepharitis, conjunctivitis, and keratitis. The lesions usually respond to dihydroxyquin. Next slide, please. Here you can see the involvement of the areas near the nose, eyes, and the mouth and cheeks. Next slide, please. Now coming on to the metabolic conditions. Peripheral cornea can be affected by the deposition of the abnormally metabolized substances, and this can lead to increased serum levels of lipid, uric acid, cysteine, mucopolysaccharides, and other metals. Next slide, please. The first one is the Wilson's disease, or also known as hepatolenticular degeneration. It is a rare inherited condition of the copper transporting protein deficiency that leads to increased levels of copper in tissue and urine excretion. Presentation includes liver disease, psychiatric disturbance, muscle stiffness, and speech problem. In eye, the case of fissure ring is seen, that is 1 to 3 mm wide, brown-yellow fine copper in the peripheral desmates membrane. The treatment is usually not required as it usually results with a systemic therapy. Penicillamine, zinc acetates are also used. Next slide, please. Here you can see a band in the superior and the inferior quadrant that represents the KF rings. Next slide, please. Now coming on to systemic pigment deposition. This one is the alkaptonuria. This is an autosomal recessive disorder of the homogentisic acid oxidase deficiency that results in an elevated level of elevated serum and tissue levels of homogentisic acid. Homogentisic acid is basically a toxin in the human body, and this leads to urine discoloration, ochronosis, outer ear discoloration, and arthritis. In eye, conjunctiva, sclera, and peripheral cornea can be discolored. Next slide, please. Here you can see how the sclera has discolored. Next slide, please. Ocular chrysiasis is essentially the gold deposits in the peripheral cornea due to systemic ingestion. This can be seen in the chrysotherapy for the rheumatoid arthritis when it exceeds the ingestion of 1500 milligrams. Treatment is usually not required. Argyrosis is the discoloration of the ocular tissues post-exposure to silver dust. It can be iatrogenic or ocular occupational exposure. Next. Here you can see how there are shiny particles in the slit. These are gold deposits on the peripheral cornea. Next slide, please. Hyperlipidemia. This results in the arcus senilis formation in the young. Usually, hyperlipoproteinemias type 2 and 3 results in juvenile arcus formation. Bilateral deposition is also seen in familial lecithin cholesterol, acyltransferase deficiency, partial and complete form. Next slide, please. You can see how the arcus has formed. Next slide. Now coming on to mucopolysaccharidosis. This is a lysosomal storage disorder of carbohydrate metabolism that is frequently resulting in corneal opacification, facial coarseness, skeletal anomalies, heart disease, and learning disabilities are seen. It results in a keratopathy of punctate corneal opacification and diffuse stromal haze. Selected gangliosidosis and mucolipidosis result in corneal stromal clouding. Here, as you can see, the center of the cornea is sort of totally opacified. Next slide. Now, coming on to porphyria cutanea. It is an inborn uroporphyrin metabolism error. Here, the hepatic dysfunction and the vesicular skin disease is seen. Ocular involvement include conjunctival bullae that may result in scarring, symblepharon, entropion, and trichiasis, or severe necrotizing scleromalacia. Peripheral cornea includes extension of the adjunct corneal melting, superficial punctate epitheliopathy. Here you can see how the skin disease is represented in the hands and ocular manifestations in the picture below in the eye. Next slide. Now coming into the other systemic diseases, the inflammatory bowel diseases affects the periphery of the cornea. These are usually of two types. The first one is the inflammatory intestinal tract disease that is usually caused by the Crohn's disease and ulcerative colitis. And the second one is the extra-intestinal cause of bowel inflammation. It can be due to arthritis, erythema nodosum, stomatitis, spondylitis, hepatitis, cholangitis, and pyelonephritis. Ocular involvement is usually seen with anterior uveitis, scleritis, conjunctivitis, episcleritis, and keratitis. Peripheral subepithelial infiltrates that usually ulcerate are seen adjacent with scleritis or episcleritis. These usually respond to topical steroids. Now coming into the blood dyscariasis. Leukemia is sort of related to the limbal vasculature, and thus the peripheral corneal involvement is seen with nodule-like formation in the limbus. The marginal ulcers with stromal infiltrate is also seen. These infiltrates may be composed of leukemic cells. And that was my presentation. Thank you so much for hearing. And these are the references that I used for preparing my slides.
Thank you so much, Anjali, for such a nice presentation. Shall we move to our discussion session now?
Yes.
If there are no any queries in the chat box, I'd like to end this session here. So I request you to share your experience about Foroptom.
I am really grateful for Foroptom to create such a platform where we can explore ourselves in order to how well we can perform if a seminar or presentation comes in. And I really want to thank Jagan for being there all the time and helping me out. Foroptom has a great team. Thank you very much for this chance.
Thank you so much. Thank you for all our audience for hearing us.
Thank you.